Well, hello, Jerry and Kimberly Dirmann here. Welcome to our Solid Life service. And I want to say to all of our house churches out there, we are so proud of you.
We're
proud of you for launching. We're proud of you for continuing. And if it hasn't started off yet the way that you had hoped, the Bible says, do not despise the day of small things. So keep it going. And of course, anyone who would like to start a house church, go to our website, solidlives.com, click on house churches, and then fill out that interest form. And we would love to help you get started and to partner with you to see that house church flourish.
Yes. And we are excited that we are here now opening our hearts to receive what God is speaking. And let me tell you, God is speaking His rhema word for us today. So let's open up our hearts.
You did join on the right day because this is really an impactful word that God has to bring today. But let's start off with some worship. Don't only worship with your lips. Jesus calls it lip service. Let's worship from our hearts. And in between the words, in between the songs, fill in from your own heart. Tell the Lord how much you love Him. And let's invite His presence right into the room where we are and where you are. Let's worship together.
Well, hey, everybody. We're going to be coming together and worshiping today. Let's bring our hearts together and let's sing today, can we? We're going to sing Stand in Your Love.
When darkness tries to roll over my bones, when sorrow comes to steal the joy I know, brokenness and pain is all I know. I won't be shaken. I won't be shaken.
Let's say it out.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
Yeah. So the second verse.
Shame no longer has a place to hide. I am not a captive to the lies.
I'm not afraid.
I'm not afraid to leave my past behind. Oh, I won't be shaken. Stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. Yeah,
yeah. Say it again, my fear.
My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love. My fear doesn't stand a chance when I stand in your love.
We say there's power.
There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave.
Resurrection.
There's resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name. Power in your name. There's power that can break off every chain. There's power that can empty out a grave. Resurrection, resurrection power that can save. There's power in your name, power in your name.
Jesus. My fear,
my
the Lord, Lord, I need you. Oh, I need you. Every hour I need you. My one defense, my righteousness. Oh, God, I need you. Lord, I come. Lord, I
says in the book of Revelation that when you listen into heaven, those words worthy, it just means value, worth. That's That's what they're being sung over and over in heaven. Worthy are you, Lord. Worthy are you. Worthy is the Lamb of God. Say one more time.
Now it's time for us to bring our tithes and offerings to the Lord. And by the way, if you have a congregation somewhere else and that's your home church, then we always encourage people to give their tithe to their home church. Hey, I want to look at Philippians chapter 4, 19 once again. And notice it says this, "And my God shall supply all your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus." And we covered several things. First of all, that it's God who supplies our need. It's not we who supply his. He doesn't need us. Our little old offerings don't help supply God's needs. He is the creator of the universe. The gold and the silver belong to him and the cattle on 1,000 hills. And then it says, "And my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory," not according to your need. But then I want to focus today on these last three words. "And my God shall supply all your need according to his riches in glory by Christ Jesus." Now, why does it say he supplies our need by Christ Jesus? Well, here's why. The book of Hebrews tells us that Jesus is our high priest. And just like in the Old Testament, when people would bring their sacrifices to God, they would bring it to the priest, and the priest is the one who would turn around and offer it on the altar to God. Well, the book of Hebrews says that this high priest of ours, Jesus, he also needs to offer gifts and sacrifices before God. And our tithe is one of those. In fact, in Hebrews chapter 7, the 8th verse, it says this, "Here mortal men," human beings, "receive tithes, but there he receives them of whom it is witnessed that he lived." Now, what does that mean? That means that we could come maybe electronically and we can give, or we bring it to a church and we give it in the basket with the ushers and such. It says human beings are collecting them, but in reality, there in heaven, our high priest of the church is receiving our tithes, turning around and offering them before Father God. This is what the priest does. But that's not all he does. He then turns around and the blessing that is promised on the tithe, that God will open the windows of heaven and pour out blessing and on all of our offerings, Jesus turns around and administers that blessing back to us. Why? He is that mediator. He is that high priest that is going between us and God. And when we come to bring our tithes, we should bring them to him. Now, yes, we do give it to our local church because the Bible says, "Bring the tithes into the storehouse that there may be food in my house." That's an earthly house here. But God says, "But if you'll do that in my house here on earth, I'll open the windows of heaven above you." So whenever you come to tithe, don't only do a transaction with your thumbs or with your hand to put it in a basket, but also with your heart and your mouth to say, Lord, you are my God, and I'm tithing to you, putting my trust in you. And I thank you that you will open the windows of heaven and pour out blessing on me. Because the Bible says that God will supply your need according to his riches and glory by Christ Jesus. This is personal between you and Jesus, Jesus and the Father, and then the Father and Jesus back to you to bless you. Now, all through the month of June 2020, for any gift of any amount, I want to send you a journal, a Solid Life journal, and a little 30 Reasons to be Saved booklet. You can read this and pass it on to somebody else. This journal has Bible reading plans in the back. This is what we all are encouraged to do. Let's read the Bible together. And then, of course, all these blank pages, you can capture what God is saying to you. So we want to send you this Solid Lives journal and the 30 Reasons for a gift of any amount, and we're about to give you the instructions right now.
To all of you who are joining us online and to our Solid Lives house churches all over the world, welcome. We are so glad you're with us. If you're a part of a Solid Lives house church, please use one of our house church giving options. For those of you joining us from the United States and Canada, you can use our convenient text-to-give option. For house churches with a certified giving keyword, text that keyword to 77977 and click on the link in the reply. For all other house churches, text SL Church to 77977 and click on the link in the reply. To make a general donation, tithe, or offering to Solid Lives, text Solid Lives to 77977 and click on the link in the reply. You can also give through our website, solidlives.com, and click Give at the top of the page. If you are joining us internationally, you can mail your donation to Solid Lives, P.O. Box 4970, Anaheim, California, 92803, USA. You can find all this information on our website by visiting solidlives.com and clicking on Give. Lastly, we want to say thank you. Thank you for partnering with us through your giving as we build solid lives and disciple people all around the world.
Hey, before we get in the word today, we're going to sing this, Not by Might. Ready?
Not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God. Not by might, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Say,
try with us.
Say, not by mind, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God. Not by mind, not by power, by your Spirit, God. Send your Spirit, God.
So you are the fire.
You are the fire, we are your temple. You are the voice, we are your song. You are our God, we are your people. You are the light, we stand in awe. We stand in awe of you.
Just one more time.
Father, we come to you in the name of Jesus, and we approach your holy, written, inspired, living, active, powerful, sharper than any two-edged sword word. And we pray that just as Ephesians 5 says, that Jesus will, with his spoken word, cleanse us and wash us and rid us from spots and wrinkles and anything in our lives that is not holy, is not pleasing. We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Amen. Well, let's open our Bibles to the 17th chapter of the book of John. And we're on this series called The Spirit and the Bride. There are many themes in the book of Acts, but two big ones are the church and also the Holy Spirit. And we've been on this study of the church and the Holy Spirit called the Spirit and the Bride. The church is the bride. Well, we studied several things, but today we're going to get to a good one, aren't we? Oh, I mean, the Holy Spirit is speaking something today that is precious and powerful.
Opening our eyes to truths that are right in front of us for today.
Absolutely. And let me just say quickly that the Lord is paralleling this year's Pentecost in 2020 with the one that happened in Acts chapter 2. Pentecost comes every year, but the one in Acts chapter 2 was special. It was the birth of the church. And the one in 2020 is the rebirth of the church. Something special happening here. And the Holy Spirit is wanting to do many similar things and sometimes all the same things as he did in Acts chapter 2. But let's start in Genesis. Well, we could start there too. Let's start in John chapter 17. And you know, in the book of John, the 13th, 14th, 15th, 16th chapters of John, this is where Jesus is sitting at the Last Supper table with his disciples the night before he died. But when we get into chapter 17, he begins to pray to the Father. What would you pray the night before you died? If you knew tomorrow you're going to die and in a few hours you're going to be arrested, what would you be praying about? Let me show you something that Jesus was praying about in John 17, 20. It says this, he prayed, Father, I do not pray for these alone, but also for those who will believe in me through their word. And so notice this, he's praying not just for the disciples that were sitting at the table, but he said, Father, I pray for those who will believe at their word. Well, John was sitting right there at the table with Jesus. In fact, he was sitting right next to Jesus because the Bible says that John laid his head on Jesus' chest at the table. And so John's right, he wrote this book. And so it couldn't get any more us that Jesus was praying for than right now while we're reading the book of John. And Jesus said, I'm also praying for those who will believe through their word. Now watch this. I'm praying that they may be one, verse 21, that they all may be one as you, Father, are in me and I in you, that they also may be one in us, watch this, that the world may believe that you sent me. Father, if they don't become one with one another and if they don't become one like I am one with you and you are one with me, that they don't become one in us, the world won't believe. But if they become one, they'll believe. Now, why is this? Well, think about the way that Jesus and the Father interacted. Jesus would say things like, hey, the works that I'm doing, it's the Father that does the works. And then he would say, I don't do anything unless I see the Father do it. I don't say anything unless I hear the Father say it. He was always giving preference to the Father, And he would say, pray to the Father. And then the Father, what did he do? Well, in Hebrews 1, he says to Jesus, your throne, O God, is forever and ever. The Father said that to Jesus. Philippians chapter 2 is where the Bible says that God the Father highly exalted Jesus and has raised him up and given him the name above every name, that at that name every knee should bow and every tongue confess that he's Lord. Well, then Jesus said when the Holy Spirit comes, he won't speak about himself. He'll speak about me. Well, what are we seeing? We're seeing the oneness of the Trinity, the Godhead, Father, Son, and Holy Spirit, but the way that they would prefer each other, the way that they would defer to each other, the way that they would honor and respect and such. And Jesus is saying, Father, you need to make them one, because when they become one, everybody will realize, hey, that's different. They're not selfish. They're not self-centered. They're not self-exalting like normal people are. They're deferring. They're preferring their brothers. Look at the way they love. Look at the way they honor. Look at the way they respect. And Jesus said, if you'll make them one that way, Father, then the world will know that you sent me. The world will know something has happened to them. Now let's go over quickly to Acts chapter 2. Acts chapter 2. And we're going to pick right up where we left off. We're studying this day of Pentecost in Acts chapter 2. And let's pick it up now in the 41st verse. It says, then those who gladly received his word, this is Peter that stood up on the day of Pentecost and preached, then those who gladly received his word were baptized, and that day about 3,000 souls were added to them, and they continued steadfastly. This is what we studied last week. And they continued steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine or teaching, in fellowship, in the breaking of bread, and in prayers. And we skipped over to that and went down to verse 46 to talk about a meeting in the temple and house to house. But let's not skip these verses now. This is what the Holy Spirit wants us to focus on. So it says, they continued, verse 42, steadfastly in the apostles' doctrine and fellowship and the breaking of bread and prayers. Then fear came upon every soul, and many wonders and signs were done through the apostles. Now watch this, verse 44. Now all who believed were together and had all things in common, and sold their possessions and goods, and divided them among all as anyone had need. What? These people that just got saved, we're still in Acts chapter 2. They're selling their possessions, and they're dividing their possessions so that anybody that has a need can have their needs supplied. Well, it continues this. If you look over at the fourth chapter, let's look there. The fourth chapter in verse 32, it says, now the multitude of those who believed were of one heart and one soul. Isn't that what Jesus prayed? Jesus said, Father, make them one. Why? Because if you make them one, the world will believe that you sent me, that I really made a difference in their life. They were of one heart and one soul. Neither did anyone say that any of the things he possessed was his own, but they had all things in common. Now, this is not socialism, because notice there's no government or laws telling them to do this. This is something that changed in their hearts. It said they had all things in common, and with great power the apostles gave witness to the resurrection of the Lord Jesus. And great grace was upon them. Now look at the 34th verse. Nor was there anyone among them who lacked. Isn't that powerful? Nobody in that church lacked. There were many thousands of people by this time. Many thousands. And it said, nor was there any among them who lacked, for all who were possessors of lands or houses sold them and brought the proceeds of the things that were sold and laid them where? At the apostles' feet, and they, the apostles, distributed to each as anyone had need. Well, that's why no one lacked. So evidently, people that owned extra homes, because they met from house to house, so everybody didn't sell their houses, then they wouldn't have a house. But if they had extra homes, then they would sell them, or extra lands and properties. They were selling these houses and properties and bringing the proceeds and laying them at the apostles' feet. And as the apostles were discerning who has need, they were distributing these goods to people. And that's why nobody in the church lacked. Folks, that's a miracle. For the human heart to be willing to give up that clutch that they have on their possessions. Now, yeah, people can give donations and they can be benevolent here and there. But to go sell your family investments, your investment properties, and not just one or two people, all of the people, it says, that had those extra properties were doing that. They were selling this. So let me ask you this. Why would they do that? Why were they doing that? Well, evidently, what it seems to clearly imply is that there was some inequity. There were some folks that had extra, and there were some folks that, I mean, they didn't have enough. They didn't even have enough to get by. And we know the history that there was Roman oppression and the taxation was very severe in these days. And there were some people that were struggling. Well, those people were there all that time. But all of a sudden, something changed. What changed? They were cut to the heart by the word of God. The word that Peter preached, along with the Holy Spirit, that was Jesus speaking through Peter. and washing those spots and wrinkles of selfishness, self-centeredness. It's all about me looking out for number one. Now, they may not have voiced it like that, but that was what they were doing. And all of a sudden, that was washed away and it was changed. Well, let me tell you, we're in a day right now where these things are the conversations of our nation. Our nation is wrestling with this racial inequality. And is there systemic racism? You know, these questions are big questions. And does everybody have a fair shot and an equal opportunity? Well, every one of us, we have our perspective on these things. And I hope your perspective is open to the Lord adjusting it as I want mine to adjust. I want the Lord to help me to see these things correctly. You know, sometimes when people get up and make their case, you begin to look and see that there may be another agenda, and it sort of leaves a bad taste in your mouth. But let me tell you, there's some reality to the fact that not everybody's on a level playing field. Some people have assets that help them to advance and to improve, and other people, they don't have anything. And it's easy for all of us to say, well, that's their decision because they didn't do this and that and the other. I want to tell you a little story of something that happened to me just in the last few days. One of our pastors, one of our Vietnamese pastors, actually, sent me a little article. And let me just read a few excerpts from this article to give you a taste of what things moved me when I read them. He said, my grandfather built a successful business in Toledo, Ohio in the 1920s. This was actually his great-grandfather. There were blacks in Toledo in the 1920s, but getting loans from white-owned banks and buildings and building businesses that catered to the broad community was not an option for the black community. During the Great Depression, my great-grandfather was doing well enough to send his kids to college. So right out of college, my grandfather was invited to join a new college graduate track at the Firestone Tire Company. Very few blacks were able to attend college in the 1930s. A black graduate also would not have been selected by the all-white management team at Firestone. I wasn't born in Iowa because we were farmers. I was born in Iowa because it was the home of Bandag, the world's largest retreader of tires, a multinational company that my grandfather helped build. There were no black executives at Bandag. Right out of college, my father also went to work for Bandag, reported directly to his father. He rose quickly to junior vice president, and we built a large house in Muscatine on a 5-acre wooded lot. And that's when everything fell apart. My dad left. My mother went out looking for work. We moved to the suburbs of Chicago and started over again with nothing. Except that's not true. Let me read that part again. My dad left. My mother went out looking for work. We moved to the suburbs of Chicago and started over again with nothing. Except that's not true. And listen to what he says. He said, my mother got the house in Muscatine. She sold that house and used the proceeds to buy a much smaller house in Glen Ellen, Illinois, a wealthy, nearly all-white suburb of Chicago. Like many white upper-middle-class suburbs, Glen Ellen had fantastic, well-funded, award-winning schools. And why were we in that wealthy community, even when we were broke? Because the value in the house we owned in Muscatine, that house, in a very real sense, gave us a second chance. Way back in the 1930s, the federal government decided that white families should be encouraged to own homes and black families should not. 70 years of policies encouraging the underwriting of white home ownership and discouraging black home ownership have led to a profoundly inequitable America. Today, the average black household has 60% of the income the average white household has, but only 10% of the household wealth. Why? Because the number one form of intergenerational household wealth in America is home ownership. Home ownership allows kids to go to college with home equity. allows wealth to be passed through generations, and it provides an economic backstop against calamity. We built a system to favor ourselves, and it worked amazingly well. Every generation of my family has benefited from the color of our skin. So I will strive to tell my story honestly, especially to myself. Those are just some excerpts, but I tell you what, I was deeply moved by some of the things that were said, honestly, that I didn't realize, I didn't know. I knew about the racial divide. I knew that, you know, the black community was not allowed to use certain restrooms or drink from certain drinking fountains. Well, I was raised in Southern California, so I didn't see all of that. But I saw it on, you know, films and movies and read about it and such. But some of this history, I didn't know. And it opened my eyes to the fact that there's a lot that I don't know, the lot that I didn't see. And I look back at my own family's history and I see, wow, I can see some advantages that we had that other folks that I know did not have. And so, yes, God has blessed and God has helped and so on. But there were some things that happened way back when that advantaged some of us and disadvantaged others. In the book of Acts, this is what happened to me. I went to bed that night. I texted this pastor back and I said, thank you so much. It really moved my heart and said a few things. But when I woke up in the morning, these passages that we're reading right here are what God brought to my mind. This article was on my mind, and the Lord began to show me in the book of Acts that the early church, their eyes were open to something they had not seen before. And they saw, hey, look, we're all brothers and sisters here, and not that the whole world is brothers and sisters. We're all children. We're all creations of God, but not everybody's in the family of God. So let me just clarify that, okay? But they began to realize, hey, there are people in the family of God here that are suffering. They're hurting. They're not doing well. And here we are with extra things, assets and things, and something changed in their hearts, and their eyes were opened. And they began to take what they had and said, here, let me help. Laid it at the apostles' feet and said, here, use this to help the people that have need. Folks, that's a life change. That is a serious heart change. And that did not happen until this event happened with the power of the Spirit and the Word of God being preached. Now, here's something else. They laid it at the apostles' feet, and the Bible says, and the apostles distributed it, distributed those goods to people as they had need. Well, the Lord connected something else for me. And I think I've seen it before, but never like this. Let's look at the sixth chapter, Acts chapter 6. In Acts chapter 6, it shows something of an inequality that came about. Acts chapter 6, and look at verse 1. It says, In those days, when the number of the disciples was multiplying, there arose a complaint against the Hellenists, by the Hellenists, because their widows were neglected in a daily distribution. Folks, we could call that complaint a protest. They were saying, we're being unfairly treated, okay? Now listen, I'm not trying to make any political statements here at all. I don't want to get on one side of an argument or another. What I want to do is I want to be in the church of the Lord Jesus. I want to be in the move of the Holy Spirit. God is rebirthing the church right now with us. He's speaking to us. Jesus is speaking his word. I want to hear what his word is saying. Notice this. The Hellenists were Greeks. They were Jews, but they were Greek-speaking Jews. And the Hebrews, these were Hebrew-speaking Jews. And so notice this. There was a complaint against the Hebrews by the Hellenists because their widows were neglected in the daily distribution. Well, who's doing the daily distribution? The apostles. So there's wealth there and it's being distributed to needs. But guess what? There's a whole people group here that are believers. They're part, but they're being neglected. They're not getting the same treatment. And so now they're raising this complaint. And I want you to notice what happens in verse 2. Then the 12 summoned the multitude of the disciples and said, it's not desirable that we should leave the word of God and serve tables. Therefore, brethren, seek out from among you seven men of good reputation, full of the Holy Spirit and wisdom, whom we may appoint over this business. Immediately, the apostle said, oh, we can't do that. We can't have this inequity. We have to take care of this. But they said, but we need to spend our time praying and ministering the word. So this is becoming larger than we can handle. Let's choose out some other people to do this. And so they chose some other men to do this. And guess what? They resolved that inequity problem. They resolved it. Now, they didn't come up with the plan immediately as to how they were going to resolve it. What they did was they said, let's get some people that are trustworthy, full of the Holy Spirit, and let's get them to come and resolve this issue, and God will give them wisdom. And that's exactly what happened. And it goes on to say that, man, the number of disciples multiplied greatly, and even priests and other people. Why? Because they were looking at the church, and they were saying, what cannot be solved in the world is being solved in the church. What the world does not have the heart to solve. They can't come to terms. They can't see eye to eye. But look at the church. Look at the believers. They're seeing these situations, and they're coming into agreement, and everybody's getting their needs met, and nobody's disgruntled about it. Everybody's happy that everybody's being helped and blessed, and they're loving each other. Folks, that's what Jesus said, and it goes on in chapter 6 to say, even many of the Jewish priests who were not believers in Jesus, they began to believe when they saw this happening. Folks, this is powerful. And now today, here we are with all this happening in our world, and right in the middle of this pandemic, right in the middle of all of this outrage at the George Floyd death and such, right in the middle of all this, riots and everything, the Lord is rebirthing the church of the Lord Jesus Christ. And Jesus is praying once again, Lord, do it again. Make the church one. Help them to see with eyes that are eyes of the Spirit and not eyes of what they even saw yesterday. See, something happened this day in Acts chapter 2. And they began to see. From that point on, they saw it differently. May we see it differently. I don't want to hold to my own view. I want to say, Lord, come, take your word. And Lord, change my view. May I see the view that you see. May I see people the way that you see people, and not just the talking points of one group or another. Lord, may I see it. And this is what the Lord wants for us. Let me tell you about my own family, okay? My own family, my parents started off very, very poor. In fact, early in their marriage, they lived in a trailer, not a mobile home. No, this was a trailer, small trailer. They did not have enough. But thankfully, you know, they were tithers and believers, and the Lord blessed them over the years. They made some mistakes, but God blessed them. And they were eventually able to buy a house, and then it grew in value. They sold it and bought another house, and they upgraded over the years and such. But I remember when my brothers and I were all in the ministry, we're all renting because we weren't in a position to be able to buy homes of our own. My parents came to the decision that they were going to sell their house and buy another house, a smaller house, but they were going to help two of my brothers to buy a house. And at the same time, God used Kimberly's grandmother to help Kimberly and me to buy a house. So all of a sudden, within about a year, all of us were in a position of being homeowners that could build some equity and value and so on. There was something great. But what my parents did sacrificially, that's the heart of the Acts Church. That's the heart of the Acts Church. I know just recently, in fact, our son came to us and daughter-in-law, and they said, hey, Mom, Dad, we want to save up for a house. Can we move in with you and save up some money so that we could buy something? And we said, what? You?
With all those grandbabies?
Yeah, exactly, right? Those beautiful grandbabies. Well, let us think about it. Okay. And we said, okay, why? Because these are our kids. These are our families. We want them to do well. We want them to be blessed. You know, I also think about Anthony. Anthony, who was a friend of Jonathan's in school, but he wasn't born again. And through the relationship with Jonathan, he began to come to church, and he got born again. And he was spending the night so much. In fact, if he missed spending the night, he said, where's Anthony, you know? And eventually he was there for years, born again, coming to church, beginning to be involved in ministry and such. And one day the Lord said to me, he called us mom and dad. We called him our son because he was always there and, you know, we loved him. But one day the Lord said, that's your son. Accept him as a son. Formalize it. And so I talked to Kimberly. I talked to our kids and they all agreed, yeah, that's the right thing. And so I took Anthony out to dinner. And we sat there and I said, I want to explain to you that I know you call us mom and dad and we call you our son and such, but I want to tell you that we're making it official. This is not, we're not adopting you. He was already of age by that time. But I said, we want to make it official. And we want you to go on vacations with us. We want you to be come over anytime you want. And whenever mom and dad go on to be with the Lord, any inheritance that we have, you'll get an equal portion just right along with our biological children. It was a big deal. It was a big decision. But the Lord put the love in our hearts for him. And he didn't have that from a father. And so we wanted to do that, but we felt like the Lord said to do it. This is a little taste. You know what he did? He was sitting across the table at the restaurant. He said, Dad, can I just get up and hug you right now? And so I said, yeah, but not too long. This is a restaurant. And so anyway, he got up and he embraced me, and it just meant so much to him, and he is our son. Well, that's a little taste, a little tiny taste, because see, a lot of this that I'm talking to you about is family. But in the early church, these were not biological siblings or aunts or uncles. No, by and large, the people that they were selling properties to give to were people that were not part of their family, but they were. Now they were. See, something happened. Something happened in the book of Acts, and we always talk about speaking with tongues or the signs, the miracles and all that, but we kind of skip over this part. But Jesus said, no, you can't skip over that. You have to be one. Yes, there are healings that need to happen. Yes, there is the gospel that needs to be preached. But if you guys are not one, the world's not going to believe you because they're going to see the same selfishness, the same looking out for number one attitude as everywhere else in the world. And boy, I tell you what, this exploded on the inside of me. And I shared it with Kimberly and she knew, oh, that's the Spirit of God. That's the Spirit of God. And for such a time as this, this is what the Lord is doing. This is what the Lord is saying. So why was the early church so benevolent? Why were they like this? I'll tell you why. Because these apostles watched Jesus give his life. Here's the Son of God on earth. And he said, I did not come to be served, but to serve and to give my life a ransom for many. They watched him work tirelessly to heal the sick and to preach and to minister to people and never to try to become the king or make me something, you know, buy me something, you know, I'd like a nice camel or no. They watched him just give and give. And then ultimately, they watched him completely lay his life down and be brutally murdered on a cross, not for himself, but so that we could have eternal life. And they watched this and they said, look at this. He gave everything for us. How could we not turn around and give our lives for the benefit of others that are in his family? And they were altered. They were changed by the Lord Jesus Christ. And this is the way God has always been. Don't think this started in the New Testament. In fact, let me just read quickly Deuteronomy 10, 16 to 18. This is where the Lord said, therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart. This is what happened in Acts chapter 2. Their hearts were circumcised. Their hearts were, in other words, that foreskin. Something needs to be cut away. There's something blocking the healthy, fruitful life that God wants us to live. And as long as that's in the way, we cannot reproduce and we cannot be fruitful. And so that needs to be cut away. And God says, no, it's not of your flesh. It's not that circumcision. The real one is in the heart. I need to cut something away. Otherwise, you're going to continue to be stunted. Oh, Lord, don't let us be stunted. Don't let us be stunted. We have to grow. And we have to be fruitful and we have to reach the world. So therefore, circumcise the foreskin of your heart and be stiff-necked no longer. For the Lord your God is the God of gods, the Lord of lords. Listen to this. The great God, mighty and awesome, who shows no partiality. the great God who shows no partiality nor takes bribes. Now watch this. Having said that, it goes on to say this. He administers justice for the fatherless and the widow and loves the stranger, giving him food and clothing. What? I thought you said he shows no partiality and turns right around. He administers justice for the fatherless, the widow, and loves the stranger, giving him food and clothing. What does this mean? Even though God shows no partiality, he does recognize a disadvantaged person. The widow, the fatherless. They don't have anybody to give an inheritance to them. They didn't get a good start. And the Bible says, he shows no partiality, but he recognizes that not everybody has the same advantage. So what is he going to do? To show no partiality, he's got to go to those disadvantaged people and lift them up and give them a shot. Oh, folks, this is our God. This is how he is. And this is how he wants us to be. He's not out for himself, but he's out for us. By the way, you know what I was just thinking today, honey? Excuse me. My dad used to love to sing. He sang in the choir, and he loved to sing solos and such. But do you know what is one of his favorite songs, if not his favorite song, was? It was a song that said, I want to spend my life mending broken people. My dad had a heart to help people that were hurting. And I remember praying, Lord, help me to have a tender heart like my dad. And because if somebody was hurting, disadvantaged, he wanted to help. He got that from the Lord. He got that from the Lord. And with all these house churches and everything that we're doing, this is the relaunch of the church. But let me tell you something. The Lord is relaunching us a new way. He's relaunching us to help people and not just to look out for ourselves. He's relaunching us to help people, to bless people, to see with new eyes, fresh eyes. You know, you said something to me, honey, about the stranger. I mentioned the stranger, and the Lord had already spoken and ministered to you. Share that.
Yeah, last year, as we were reading through the Old Testament from Leviticus 19, I mean, we've read through the Old Testament how many times, right? Many times. Yeah. But this time, it's like I saw it for the first time. I recognized that Leviticus 19:33 says this, and if a stranger, somebody that's not like you, if a stranger dwells with you in your land, you shall not mistreat him. The stranger who dwells among you, listen to this, shall be to you as one born among you.
Wow.
The stranger that lives in your land shall be to you as though he or she was born right in your own place, in your own home. And it says, and you shall love him as yourself. And what is that? That's Mark 12:31. Jesus said the whole law hangs on two things. If you love the Lord with all your heart, soul, mind, and strength, and you love your neighbor as yourself. And here Leviticus brings that. The neighbor is also the stranger, someone we're not acquainted with necessarily in our ways and our customs and our cultures. And yet, they will be to you as though they were born right there, a part of you. That's a love that is uncommon.
Yeah, that's right.
Because a stranger does not put a limit on who that person is. That's everybody. That's anybody, regardless of whether they look like me, talk like me, think like me. That person, the Bible says, you treat them as though they were one of your own. Oh, that's the kind of love that will turn the world upside down.
You see what the Lord's doing? The Lord is right here in this same chapter. This is not going off script.
Yeah.
This is the Lord saying, oh no, this is Pentecost. This is what the Holy Spirit does. This is what Jesus does. And the Lord now, in his goodness, is saying, I'm not going to skip over this with you and let you just have a half-hearted relaunch. I want to do the same powerful Holy Spirit work in your heart that I did in the early church. And we should say, yes, Lord, come do it. In fact, would you invite the Lord with me just right now? Say, Lord, come. Come and change my heart. Lord, help me to see. Help me to understand. Help me to do what you want me to do, Lord. In Jesus' name. Lord, we invite you right now into the rooms where we are, right here where we are, right here where all of these people are, the person that's watching. Lord, I pray that you'd come by your Spirit right now. Minister in Jesus' name. As I was preparing for this, this song kept coming up, and this has happened the last several weeks, and I know some of you are probably wondering, you're not going to sing again, are you? Well, unfortunately, yes, and I'll just say again, I'm not a singer, but I am a worshiper. But I had a song come up, and it's a song that actually I feel like a little tune that the Lord gave me about 3 years ago, and it's about this making us one, and Jesus wants us to be one. And we can do this. You know why? Because we have His help. We have the help of the Holy Spirit. We can do this. But it just goes like this. Come and make us one, Lord. Fill us with your love, Lord. Help us to be more like you. Compassion for our brother, preferring one another. Teach us, Lord, to be like you are to us. Come and make us one in you. Sing that with us, would you? Come and make us one, Lord. Fill us with your love, Lord. Help us to be more like you. Compassion for our brother, preferring one another. Teach us, Lord, to be like you are to us. Come and make us one in you. Now listen to this little verse, okay? Jesus is modeling this for us and showing us how to do it. Listen to this. Hours from indictment, before all the excitement, praying not for you, but that we would become one. In agony while hanging, the crowd viciously shaming, Father, please forgive, for they know not what they do. Lord, please make us more like you. Sing that last part, Lord. Oh, Lord, please make us more like you. Come and make us. Come and make us one, Lord. Fill us with your love, Lord. Help us to be more like you. Compassion for our brother, preferring one another. Teach us, Lord, to be like you are to us. Come and make us one with you. Let's sing it one more time, can we? I know it takes a little bit to learn, but can we now sort of not just learn it, but can we sing it from our hearts? And let's literally invite the Lord to come right in and to begin to do that cutting of the heart and opening of the eyes and changing of our lives. Folks, we can do this because He's helping. He's speaking His word even today and cleansing us from things. Don't hang on to those things with arguments. Say, Lord, anything that's not what you want, wash it away. I want to go into this next season and be exactly what you want. Come on, let's sing together. Come and make us one, Lord. Fill us with your love, Lord. Help us to be more like you. Compassion for our brother, preferring one another. Teach us, Lord, to be like you are to us. come and make us one in you. Come and make us one in you. Come and make us one in you. And Lord, we're inviting you to come and to do in our churches, in our hearts, what you want us to do. Lord, don't leave us like we are. We've been blinded to many things. We haven't wanted to see many things. But Lord, we pray in Jesus' name that you'd open our eyes, open our hearts, open our lives, so that we might be like you. We want to be like you, Lord. We want to be like you. We pray it in Jesus' name. Let me mention one more thing before we go to our little closing announcements here, and that is, you know, when you take the eternal view and you realize this life is so short, the Bible says it's like a vapor of smoke. It's going to quickly be over, but eternity lasts forever. And we're going to be in eternity with all these brothers and sisters, many of whom struggled. Folks, now's the time to say, let's live with the eternal view. Let's live with God's view. He gives it to us in His precious word. I really don't know exactly how this is going to play out, but I don't care. The Holy Spirit's leading us a step at a time, just walking this out with the Word, isn't it right? Yeah.
And He'll lead us as believers. He'll begin to show us, this is what it looks like in your life, and this is what it looks like together. But it will make a difference, a significant difference.
I can see house churches that care for each other, help each other, treat each other like family, since they are. May that happen in every house church.
May it happen in every home.
Every home. God is real. And I hope you can sense His Spirit with simplicity, but power. It's changing us, calling us deeper to be like Jesus. May it be so.
May it be so.
We pray it in Jesus' name. Amen. Praise God. And let me just say to all of you who are part of a Solid Lives House Church, we're so proud of you, and I pray that the sweet love of the Lord and the presence of the Holy Spirit is coming right into that home where you are. And I also want to say to anyone watching who you feel called or you would be willing to pray about starting a house church in your home or in someone else's home, we'd love to partner with you and to have you be a part of the Solid Lives House Church Network. And there's so much that God's going to do that we haven't even talked about yet with, you know, Operation Solid Lives Discipleship and the BFAM Training Center for Ministry Training. There's so many things that the Lord's going to bring about. But right now, we're just launching house churches. And so if you're interested in this, then I want you to go to solidlives.com and click on house churches. And you'll find there among some videos, you'll also find an interest form. If you fill out the interest form, it just takes a few moments, then we'll help walk you through the process of becoming a certified Solid Lives House Church. Now, you don't have to be certified, but by being certified, then we'll have a connection, we'll have regular meetings, we'll train you. I would love to open the Word of God, just open the Bible and show you how to pastor, how to lead. It'll be the fellowship and the camaraderie of being ministry partners in the Lord. And so God is doing this. We have so many that are already in the pipeline and that are moving towards certification. Those of you that are in the pipeline, hang in there. There are a few things that we had to work through because this is all being developed. But let me tell you, we're just about there. And oh, house church leaders are going to be certified like crazy in just the next couple of weeks. And so we're proud of you. Stay with us. And those of you that would be willing to open up a house church, go to solidlives.com and fill out that interest form. And let's get after this thing. Let's believe God that He's going to spread this all across America. We're going to take back America house to house. Stay tuned for these closing announcements.
The Solid Lives House Church Network. We invite you to be a part of this incredible movement. Whether you have years of training or none at all, God wants to use you right where you are to impact your family, your neighborhood, and your community. Go to solidlives.com and click House Churches at the top of the page. Here you will find resources for leading a house church, including free training materials. And if you're interested, make sure to fill out the interest form so we can be in touch with you as we start this journey together. To stay up to date, follow us on social media and subscribe to our YouTube channel. And for more teachings and resources, visit our website at solidlives.com. Thank you for joining us.